NVIDIA collaborator and partner SandboxAQ has been at the forefront of implementing its own AI innovations in sectors like defense and healthcare and financials. Joining us here at Post 9 to discuss is SandboxAQ CEO Jack Hidary. Jack, welcome. Good to have you.
Good to see you, Morgan. Good to see you.
First of all, most broadly on policy, is there a sense in the industry that it's kind of like shackles off here?
Well, I think what we'll see is a focus on transparency and disclosure. What we want to avoid is surprises. We don't want to wake up one day to the news here on CNBC that our electric grid went down because we depended on some AI that we didn't know about. And so what I think you'll see consistent is disclosure and transparency. I think the United States is going to take an approach that is pretty light in terms of regulation overall, because the most dangerous thing is not runaway AI, it's AI that we don't use. Right. If we want to solve big problems in medicine, if we want to have new treatments, if we want to have an efficient way of creating new materials for cars, automotive, space. I know you're into space and cover space a lot. Then we need AI. And so that's actually the biggest danger, is that we don't use it where we need it in society.
So this age old notion that the government is often the last to really capitalize on emerging innovations, you think that changes?
I think we're going to see a concerted effort to really use AI in a major way. But more importantly, to encourage new companies and also, most importantly, B2B, big enterprises across the United States and across the world to use AI in their actual operations. To date, Carl, all we've seen is marginal, shallow uses of AI. Some cost savings in customer service, things like that. What we have not seen yet is real core product development. And that means we've got to shift from large language models, LLMs, to large quantitative models, models that really know how to create new products.
How does this speak to what's working and what's not, what's overhyped, and what actually is going to deliver on the promise?
Well, great question. We look at NVIDIA, for example, right? We saw the earnings yesterday. How long can they sustain such monster, you know, kind of quarters? And what I would say is, if we want to see that kind of sustaining blowout quarters, quarter after quarter, for say the next 2-3 years, what we're going to have to see is a shift just from the demand being consumer side. Right now, we're seeing most of the demand paying $20 a month using OpenAI. That's a good initial start for AI. But that's not going to sustain NVIDIA going to $5-7 trillion in market cap. What do we need to see that? We need to see different sovereign entities, that is different countries, wanting to build their own data centers. Jensen mentioned this in his earnings. He knows that's one of the critical things. Number two, we need to see really big business actually using AI, not just consumers. We haven't seen that shift yet.
I was going to say, that's why Jensen's trip to Japan was so interesting, right? I mean, he's been talking about sovereigns for a long time.
Yeah.
But this was a real step to say we're not just about these four hyperscalers.
Right. And let's look at the Gulf region. So you're
going
to see
that's
a lot
of exactly
in the Gulf.
Where I was going with you. Because we have restrictions in place, and those need to be lifted potentially.
Right. We just came back from Riyadh, just came back from Abu Dhabi, just landed a few days ago. And what we're seeing is Riyadh made a big announcement with Google as an example. They're contracting to use many more TPUs from Google, but also GPUs from NVIDIA, right? They want to have as many as possible. You're going to see the Emirates make more and more announcements there as well. But we also need to see the largest global 1,000 companies really shift into AI, again, not just on customer service, but product development. And that means quantitative AI, not language AI. AI that knows biology, knows how to make a new drug like Sanofi, and other kind of companies using AI now to make actual new product. That's what we haven't seen in big numbers yet.
Are you a fan of this notion that there's some kind of wall in scaling? That the kind of thing that Jensen pushed back on this week?
The wall really is around the data. And here's the issue. The issue is that how do you defend the model on the language side when everyone has the same amount of data? Right? They all just suck in, hoover in the whole internet and basically train their models on that. So where's your differentiation? Where's your moat around that? And what I think is going to happen is people realize they have to go beyond the language moat, the language data, and go to numerical data. And that comes from sensors. It comes from engineering. It comes from equations. And so I think that the next big leap in AI is not going to come from trying to fiddle around with how much data do you have, how much language do we have. It's really going to be a big jump into the numerical side.
Which also I think is the big argument, the big push, which I know Jensen has made as well for industrial AI and the fact that we're on the precipice of that. So what does this mean for what you're seeing at your company and the value proposition you're putting out to the market and how quickly you're growing in response to it?
Well, SandboxAQ, we've been very fortunate to be from the beginning focused on this quantitative AI side, this LQM side. And that means that big companies like Sanofi, big organizations like Michael J. Fox Foundation, we just announced those two here on CNBC, that they're using our AI to make new drugs, new biomarkers for Parkinson's, for Alzheimer's, for cancer. These are the critical areas we want to address. Talk about a wall. We've tried, the industry has tried for 40 years to get new medicines to areas here and failed. Humans are not as good at that. We don't need an AI that's as good as humans. We need an AI that's better than humans when it comes to developing new drugs. And so SandboxAQ now is the global pace setter in using AI to develop these kinds of new products. And that's why I think we're seeing this traction. What we had to do is partner with chip companies like NVIDIA. And the core NVIDIA, the real secret sauce is not the hardware itself. It's the CUDA software that's embedded in the chip. CUDA is that firmware that you speak to. When we write an application, when OpenAI writes applications, we write it to CUDA, CUDA, which is inside every NVIDIA chip. Our ability to work with NVIDIA and expand CUDA to have these new use cases, that's the secret sauce that's really driving the adoption of NVIDIA. And I think right now, Jensen has 50% of his people in his company focus on hardware, but 50% are focused on software. That's what people don't realize. NVIDIA is really a software company hiding inside of a hardware company. Yep. And I think that's going to be critical. But don't count out AMD and others, because I think we'll see Lisa make some interesting moves. And also, I think Google and Alphabet with its TPU and other makers with their individual ASICs, I think we're going to see some interesting announcements there. Also look out for a private company that's going public soon called Cerberus. Cerberus has filed to go public. It's going to public very, very soon, next few weeks. Yep. Probably you'll cover it here. And that's a wafer-sized chip. And so I think we're going to start seeing more diversity. And when you go into a data center in the next 2-3 years, you're not going to just see one type of chip. Mm. I think you'll see diversity. Majority will be NVIDIA. I think they'll still remain the big gorilla on the street. But I think we'll start to see specialized chips that do specialized things as well.
Jack, that's good stuff. Street obviously cannot get enough information around it. Thanks for coming in.
Great to see you.
Good to see you, Jack Hidary.